chairing this session. Next, now may I invite Dr. N.P. Gupta to conduct the next session. And this whole thing is about, we heard the debate, but nevertheless, we are in the process of making the Indian guidelines. And I would like to have Dr. N.P. Gupta, sir, to give what is the progress so far we have made while we are making the Indian guidelines.
Thank you, Dr. Samnis, for giving this time slot in this busy scientific program. Friends, you have heard the debate, and you can understand how big is a Herculean task to make the guidelines. Now, what I will tell you that the story, how the thing have started. Under the aegis of Urology Society of India, we have Indian School of Urology, and I was requested to take this responsibility. I had a lot of debate in my mind whether we will be able to do it or not, but we thought if I don't take the responsibility, then it will go to somebody else and somebody has to take the responsibility. So in 2017, we took this responsibility. Now, why we need the guideline? It has been already discussed that the guidelines are to guide treating doctor and help in standardization of treatment of a disease. And it is not necessary that in every patient you follow the same, but you can follow the principle in the same way. And guideline-based treatment also saves doctor from the litigation. Now, we thought that we have many topics in urology. Why not to take the common topics? So we decided to take these 12 topics. And then because of the background experience of each convener, we decided to make them as convener. What we did, we circulated this news to the USI members through their newsletter and website. And the information was sent that any member of the USI who is interested to join any of these team, they can contact. And a lot of members responded to the conveners, and then the conveners decided their team. So each convener has made their team. They have about 8 or 10 or 15 members in every group. And then the task was divided among the committee members by the convener, and each member started work on these guidelines. Now, this is the main thing what has been discussed previously, that methodology. We had a lot of debate how to make these guidelines. We have gone through all those guidelines which have been shown here by Dr. Shailesh Shah and Ganesh. Apart from that, we have also known now what are the lacunes in those guidelines, why they did not survive actually. And then we also saw the AUA guideline, EAU guideline, SIU guidelines, NICE guidelines, and all that. Finally, we have decided that our guidelines should have level of evidence and grade of recommendations as per the standard. This website is there, and the evidence-based level of evidence has to be there in every topic. Each topic discussion should be followed by a statement or recommendations. The recommendation should be graded according to the level of evidence. Now, these are the websites. If anybody is interested, they can go into that. We have made our guidelines on a fresh pattern, not as a copy of any existing guidelines. Now, this was decided very clearly that we should not copy the guidelines from AUA or EAU or SIU or something like that. Then the statement should be relevant to our population as well as far as possible, and also having economic concern of our large population. So this was especially instructed to the conveners to keep in mind the cost effectiveness, which Dr. Ganesh mentioned in his lecture. Now, financial assistance, you have already heard, we have requested the Urology Society of India to provide the funds, and as usual, we got the reply, no. And we have decided amongst all the conveners, this is not my individual work, that no pharmaceutical company is to be involved with the guidelines in any way. Now, this has been decided, and I'm sure all the conveners are following that. If they have to meet, they can meet during the one of these conferences or the meetings. And otherwise, now with this the digital thing which is going on, they can have video conferencing, they can sit in one place, and they can communicate with each other. We are communicating with all the conveners every 2 or 3 months. I'm keeping a track what is the progress going on. Now, what has happened so far? Online questionnaire-based monkey survey of USI members was done by the conveners.
Urinary incontinence and stricture urethra guidelines drafts are ready in December 2018. Now, these drafts were uploaded in USI website for members' comments. We have received few comments as well from the members back on these guidelines which have been made. The summary of these guidelines, two guidelines, will be presented here today. And following this, it will be submitted to the official journal of USI, that is the IJU, for peer review, and hopefully will be published soon. So that Shailesh, what he complained that they were not publicized or something, no, it is not like that. We have already made a plan that these guidelines have to be up to the standard. They have been submitted to the IJU. IJU, you all know it very well, the standard of the IJU. Dr. Rajiv Kumar, I have discussed with him. And they will send it to their peer review. They will again cross-check everything. And then if it is accepted, then they will be published in the IJU. And once they are published, then they become the official guideline. Till that time, whatsoever you call them, survey and or individual opinion or something, that's a different matter. But once it is published, I think so, then we get the authenticity. Now, task at hand and challenges. Now, it is a making of the guideline is a continuous process. It is not like that ki today we have made something in 2019, they will be ever, no. Each convener has been requested that they should review the guidelines again every 3 months, 6 months, once a year, and whenever they find that some major changes are required, then they can revise the guidelines. They can again call their all committee members so that every once in 2 or 3 years we should have the revised guidelines. And that is the dynamic process what Shailesh mentioned. Unfortunately, the previous guidelines what you saw, they were not reviewed after that. Or expanding the scope and adding more topics. We have some topics we have again thought of VUR, painful bladder syndrome, GOTV, positive cell valve, neurogenic bladder. Anyway, so this is the again open invitation to you all. If you are all interested, please write to me or send me an email. We will consider the new names of the conveners and we will decide the new topics more. May now I request Dr. Sanjay Sinha to please come on the dais. He is going to give the summary of the incontinence guidelines, and then Dr. Sanjay Kulkarni, please come here. He has prepared the guidelines, draft, I will say at the moment, to present on the stricture urethra. Dr. Sanjay Sinha, please.
Good morning, everyone. So over the next few minutes, I'm going to present to you a summary of what we have done for the creation of the Union Contents Guidelines. Clearly, 7 minutes or 6 minutes is not enough to present the guidelines, and I don't intend to do that either. Can I have a show of hands? How many of you have actually seen the guidelines? Okay, a few of you have. Those of you who have not, I request you to go on the USI website and take a look at it. Now, just some background on what we did. So in July of 2017, I was given the mandate for creating this guideline, and we invited expressions of interest from the USI membership in August. By September, we finalized our guidelines committee, and we finalized the format after a two-month deliberation of the guidelines itself. And then over the next 6 months or so, we did multiple training sessions of a core group. So we had a core group of 5 people. We did multiple training sessions based on the Cochrane methodology. On how to go about doing the guideline process. And then by April, we had finalized the search terms. This was a very critical part of doing the guideline process. We did our first literature search reconciliation and cross-check by July and compiled the evidence somewhere between May and September of 2018. And then we had the first sit-down of the core group in September of 2018. Over the next 3 months, we created different versions of the guidelines, and by December, we were actually ready with the 6th version, which was the one which was uploaded onto the USI website. We invited membership comment, and we have had a few comments, and though we wrote as 31st December as the cutoff for comments on the guidelines, please feel free to go ahead and still contact us if you have any comments regarding the guidelines. And we intend to submit the final guidelines in February for publication, hopefully in the IJU. Some more background. The core group was constituted by these 5 people. Other than me, we had Dr. Mayank from Guntur, Dr. Pavan, Dr. Nikhil from Delhi, and Dr. Vijay, who was originally in Hyderabad and then moved to Delhi. We have had close to 100 web meetings with each other. We have had 2 sit-downs in September and November of 2018. And you all know the ancillary activity regarding the survey that we did. And just to place on record, because we've had a lot of discussion over the last few minutes regarding support and finance, we have taken no industry support for anything. So even for the sit-down meetings that we have done, when required, we have purchased our own tickets by flight or whatever. So there's been no industry support. We've had no financial support from the USI either. This would not have been possible because it's not just a question of trying to arrange sit-down meetings. There is an expense involved in looking at literature. That's the major expense. Fortunately for us, over the last 2 years, we've had the Sci-Hub website, which most of you know about. And so by a combination of Sci-Hub, which gave us access to almost 80 to 90% of literature free of cost, and plus our own memberships to most of the major societies, we were able to access almost all the literature that we needed, because that's the major expense when you create a guideline. What was the philosophy behind what we did? We examined all the global evidence. Remember, all the countries make their own guidelines, and the evidence is the same. So the AUA guideline is based on all evidence, including the evidence that comes from India. And the Indian guideline is also based on all the evidence, including the evidence that comes from India or the US or UK. So we examined all Indian evidence, we examined all high quality evidence, and we did a complete search. So we've not done it, say, a last 3 year search, which we had originally planned to do. We did a complete search. We went back to the drawing board and did it based on some of the feedback that I received last year from Dr. Rajiv as well as from Dr. Nitin Kekre. We then examined this in the context of the Indian healthcare system and socio-cultural economics to create final guideline recommendations. So I'm now just going to summarize some key aspects of the 3 slides, telling you how we differ from the other guidelines. So there's no point going through all the guideline statements. We just don't have time for that right now. The first is, we always feel that we don't have evidence in terms of what's the prevalence of a condition itself. So to start with, so when we really went back and checked the evidence, there are in fact 9 population-based door-to-door surveys on urinary incontinence prevalence from India. And these are all available but never compiled. So now we are actually, as a part of the guidelines, we will give you age-adjusted prevalence for guidelines for urinary incontinence in India. So this is something which is not there. It's actually there but never compiled and given to you. So if somebody asks you, do you have incidence of urinary incontinence in India, the answer is yes, you do. And we've given you a table for that, including the age-adjusted prevalence. We have a new definition for what constitutes uncomplicated stress incontinence, and this is a more stringent definition. The reason why we've done this is based on the fact that we've had a lot of problems in terms of across the world in terms of patient outcomes, and we feel that a more stringent definition of what constitutes uncomplicated stress incontinence is important. We also have a new definition for refractory urgency incontinence. The reason for this is that the existing definition, there's only one definition from the AUA, is an incomplete and a dated definition. The AUA definition does not include the need for using both mirabegron as well as antimuscarinics. We feel that today, because the combination of these therapies is shown to be superior to either drug alone, the definition must include use of a combination therapy. The definition also needs to include use of a mandatory voiding diary, because even in the US system, 1 in 4 American doctors who are treating patients for refractory do not actually do a voiding diary before they make that conclusion. And it's very clear that that is actually a travesty in terms of the patient treatment. So you must have a voiding diary before you make conclude that the patient has refractory urgency incontinence and go on to invasive therapies. There's a new definition for pelvic floor muscle training, which mandates that the training must include physical verification of contraction and relaxation of the right set of muscles. Because just telling somebody what's pelvic floor muscle training is not enough. It's too less time to do this. We have a recommendation for urodynamics for refractory urgency incontinence. We have a recommendation for urodynamics and cystoscopy for post-prostatectomy incontinence. It's just not enough time to go into this for what reasons. We have also got a recommendation for the use of propanthiolene when you are faced with severe financial constraint, and we've given you an economics table at the end of the document. There's a position statement on the use of synthetic tapes. There's a recommendation against a clinical use of lasers for clinical management of stress incontinence, not against the use in research protocols. And the cost of various pharmacotherapies. So I would like to conclude that this is an ongoing process. You need a regular updating, and we will do that updating. You need to use the guidelines in your clinical practice. If you don't agree with what we have written, write to us, argue with us, present evidence to the contrary, and make us change our positions. There's no point just cribbing about it. You have to get back with the evidence, tell us where we are wrong, and we will work with you to satisfy you. You need to quote the guidelines. If you don't use the guidelines, if you don't ask your residents to read the guidelines, you don't make it a part of the examination system, it's of no use. So we believe that if we give you a guideline which is worthy of the association, which is worthy of our organization, it will be read by residents and doctors. I am sure every resident and doctor reads what is good for them. They like to read something which gives meaning. If we create a guideline, I was part of the guidelines of 2006-07 of one of those committees, and I know what we created. That was not up to standard. It was not a guideline at all. But what we are doing today is a guideline, and I believe if we give you something which is worthy of the association, and that was the only thought behind all this when we did it. We've put in hundreds of hours over the last 1.5 years. The only reason we've done it is that we want that whatever document we give you is a document that you can be proud of. We have had an incredible team. We've had a very supportive USI, and I must convey my gratitude to Dr. N.P. Gupta because he's really been an inspirational figure in the development process. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sanjay. May I request Sanjay Kulkarni now?
Good morning. Professor N.P. Gupta, thank you for inviting me as a convener for this prestigious USI guidelines. I was part of the ICUD guidelines published on stricture urethra in 2010, and I was also reviewer of the AUA guidelines on urethral stricture. EAU does not have guidelines for stricture urethra. They have guidelines on only trauma. We formed a committee, as Professor Gupta said. The email was sent to all the members of USI, and those who responded and were interested in the committee, they were all included. And we had seniors like Amil Albert and Bhatial, and and Deepak Dubey, who has published a lot of papers. And these juniors, Nikhil Khattar, Arvind Panda, Dr. Dangi, Batra and Pankaj Joshi, they really did the majority of search and work. The procedure is that we interacted on internet platform and phone calls. A WhatsApp group was formed, literature review was performed using keywords, and we had a look into consideration about the latest studies, high impact papers, Indian papers published in IJU, and randomized studies. And we had a meeting about a month ago in Pune. All these people came together, and we had 1.5 days of meeting, and we sat down and wrote the guidelines. And this is the outline of the guidelines. We have two levels of recommendation, strong and weak, because we did not want to copy. We have not copied anything from any AUA or EAU guidelines. These are original Indian guidelines. So we have provided definitions. So how do we differ, as Dr. Sanjay Sinha says? If you look at the bulbar urethra, ICUD guidelines suggest bulbar urethra is that portion of the urethra which is inside the bulbo spongy muscle. What happens to that urethra from that point to the penoscrotal junction? So we have an urethroplasty surgeon definition, bulbo membrane junction to the penoscrotal junction. So this definition is not anatomical, but this is practical definition. So we have classification as far as the location and etiology of the stricture and the type of procedure that we recommend. We have clinical principles which are common to all urethral strictures, like we assess the patient with an IPSS, uroflow, post-void residue, and we do sonography of the upper tract, and then we ask for an RGU, an MCU, or Americans called it VCUG, and use of intra urethral methylmblue just prior to surgery to stain the stricture urethra. And then we have what we advocate is that blind dilatation with metal bougies should not be used. For strictures of the meatus and navicular fossa, the normal meatus around the world is 25 French. When the shape, which is vertical slit, turns circular, then we call it and it becomes narrow, we call it a meatal stenosis. The etiology could be post-instrumentation lichen sclerosis, which is common in India. And the treatment is dilatation, if it doesn't work, meatotomy and meatoplasty. Coming to penile urethral strictures, dilatation, we all know, rarely cures a stricture, and it should be used for those patients who are unfit for surgery, the patient refuses surgery, or after multiple failed urethroplasties. DVIU in penile urethra has a weak recommendation, CIC again a weak recommendation, and we should offer urethroplasty in most of the patients. for penile urethroplasty. These are now clinical-oriented recommendations depending upon papers published from India, that for non-lichen sclerosis, if you can pass a ureteroscope, which is six or seven French, we can perform a single-stage dorsal inlay or only urethroplasty. For narrow urethra, which accommodates only a guide wire, then one should consider a Johansson type 1 urethroplasty, and in the second stage, one should do a ASOPA dorsal inlay. For lichen sclerosis, we advocate that the single-stage dorsal buccal mucosa is an ideal situation. Orandi flap should be used rarely, and buccal mucosa placed ventrally in the penile urethra is not recommended. Now, failed hypospadias is a very complex situation, and again, for those patients who have a reasonable urethral plate, one can do an ASOPA dorsal inlay or a flap, and for those patients whose stricture is too bad, have multiple fistulas, then we advocate a two-stage procedure. For bulbar urethral stricture, for trauma, we want to do an anastomotic urethroplasty, augmented anastomosis when the gap is too long or it's a failed anastomosis. For non-trauma, we advocate single DVIU. For short strictures, for long strictures, surgery directly. The success rate of third DVIU is 0%. This is mentioned in American urology guidelines on stricture urethra. The patient should know that after third DVIU, the success rate is zero. And CIC after DVIU is technically not recommended. For bulbar urethral stricture, when to do dorsal only, when to do ventral only, we have categorized depending upon the etiology of the stricture, the site of the stricture, and the approaches that we have described here. For panurethral stricture, we know that dilatation is palliative, DVIU has no role, and we ask we suggest that we do a single stage repair. And for those patients whose urethra is really tight, we advocate a two-stage procedure. For pelvic fracture urethral defects, immediate treatment is supraorbital cystostomy followed by delayed repair, preoperative penile Doppler if the patient gives history of erectile dysfunction. Intraoperative endoscopy is important just before anastomosis to make sure that you are doing anastomosis to the right spot, and MRI and CT will be ordered when indicated. Anastomotic urethroplasty, this is important, that when I pass a dilator from above and I can't feel the bougie in the perineum, many people started doing transpubic directly, so I insert a left index finger to identify in which direction to do, and this is not described in any textbook. Then scar excision, crural separation, and proper anastomosis is what we require, and occasionally we get patients of bulbar urethra necrosis where there is no bulbar urethra and we advocate a pedicle pupitial tube. Now DVIU is reserved for short, single, short bulbar stricture, non-traumatic in origin. The success rate of third DVIU again is 0%. The use of laser and cold knife is equal, so the laser has actually no advantages. And there are some special circumstances which I have quoted, and we have given recommendations to all these special circumstances like the neurogenic bladder on CIC, role of urodynamics and everything. So these guidelines are there on the USI website. I request you to go there. And there are a lot of references also. If there are any suggestions, we can accommodate them. And then thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Sanjay. So friends, you have heard about the summary of the, this is the tip of the iceberg, what you have seen. But I request you all to go into the website and see these guidelines. If you like to make any comments, you are most welcome. And now, because of the shortage of the time, we will not like to have any question answer discussion. But my request to the USI Council, as you have heard, funds are important. And we assure you that your funds will be used only if it required. Otherwise, we will not use it. And second thing is the new team is coming now. I request them to give us another slot next year. And we promise you all that we are sure that in next year, we will be able to make one or two or three more guidelines, and we will come back to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. N.P. Gupta. Now we go next to a very interesting debate, and I call upon Dr. Anand Kumar on the dais to moderate this debate. Well, the whole idea of this debate is that we keep on hearing and we keep on discussing that for a good robotic surgeon, He must have to have a laparoscopic experience, then only he can become a good robotic surgeon. Well, there are plus and minus and for and against views, and this is exactly what the debate is for. Now I request Dr. Anand Kumar to take the charge and conduct this debate.
Okay, thank you. Now this is a very interesting debate. Is lap surgery skill required to be good robotic surgeon? And we have two young, very skilled surgeons to speak for and against, Dr. Rishi Nair and Dr. Gautam Chaudhary. Please come to the dais. You both have 10 minutes to go and 2 minutes of rebuttal. So first, Dr. Rishi Nair, who is, I think you are associate professor, additional?
Still assistant, sir. The DP is
professor in All India Institute of Medical Science. Sure. And you are going to speak for the for the lap surgery skill, yes, is required for the robotic surgery.
So this is the last scientific session, and I have been asked to defend on the side of that lap surgery skills are definitely required to be a good robotic surgeon. Well, let me start with a sixer here. There is no such thing called as a good robotic surgeon. In robotics, there is always a team that is working during surgery, and it can only be a good robotic team. So we can't exclude the assistant who is standing by the patient's side from the robotic surgery at all. Even the mighty Tendulkar could not achieve his life cherished goal of winning a World Cup till he got a good robotic team by his side. So therefore, no point harping the fact that you are a good robotic surgeon. There is no such thing as a good robotic surgeon. And nobody can do it alone. In the 2 decades of robotic surgery, not a single robotic surgery has yet been done. There is no such robot that doesn't require assistant to be patient's side. Now, what a master robotic surgeon is looking for in his practice? Does anybody know? I will tell you the reality. The reality is, if you fill this robotic surgery keyword in any job portal site of your choice, this is what you get. Assistant surgeon. Assistant surgeon is the one who is in demand, not the robotic console surgeon. And you go down, it is again assistant, 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 and assistant. And it continues. There is no demand for a robotic surgeon. Demand is only for a laparoscopic skilled assistant. Why so? Because laparoscopic surgery is essential part of robotics, and without it, it cannot proceed. So even the master robotic surgeons are actually looking for only laparoscopic assistants, nothing else. And situation is going from bad to worse. Now even the advertisements are classifying that they need excellent surgical assistants by the patient to stand by the patient's side. So it is actually very clear that as more robots are being sold, the demand is for skilled laparoscopic assistant and not robotic surgeons. The laparoscopy is difficult to learn, and therefore it has become the limiting factor for the robotics to spread. So actually, robotic is attached at its navel to laparoscopy. If you still do not agree, let us take away the skilled lap assistant from the Dr. Chaudhary's OT, and we will see what the scene is inside the OT. Now even he will agree that just holding a suction and giving counter traction properly, he would consider it as a good laparoscopic skill. We are not talking only of laparoscopic suturing here. Even just retracting properly is a good laparoscopic skill, which is essential part of a robotic surgery. So again, suction, irrigation, counter traction, applying hemolock clips, vascular, and the list is end on. So just don't go by the dictum that suturing is the only laparoscopic skill. Even inserting veres properly is a good laparoscopic skill, and it is essential part of robotics also. So all these things cannot be done without a proper laparoscopy. Even if the console surgeon is inserting his own ports, he has to know how to insert the ports properly. The port position is an important laparoscopic skill. And the assistant is not working with the simple laparoscopy. You see, the 1:1 principle of standard laparoscopy goes for a toss during robotics.
he has to either work with his extended arms or the distance from the port to the holding the instrument is too far away for a proper ergonomic functioning of the laparoscopic assistant. So the skills for the assistant to assist during robotics is much more than in a pure laparoscopy. Not only this, the vision is either cranially located because the giant called the robot is occupying this space both in front and the backside of the patient. Therefore, the assistant has to see either cranially or caudally, and he has to work in the other direction. So again, it is a heightened skill of laparoscopy that is at play during any robotic surgery. So as I said, even in literature, the robotic surgery is no more referred to as robotic surgery. The term has been replaced by robot-assisted laparoscopy, because at the end of the day, this every robotic surgery is actually laparoscopy only. And as it stands, all robotic training either imparts or expects the domain laparoscopic knowledge and skills to be there even in the console surgeon. You look at any current standard of robotic training, be it the FRS, FSRS, or the European Robotic Surgery Training Curriculum, all of them would expect a core laparoscopic knowledge before anyone tries to learn the robotic surgery. And it is proven that beginners who have no laparoscopic background, they get lost in the anatomy. There are reasons to it. There is a lack of haptic feedback. If somebody knows how to do laparoscopy, even if only few laparoscopic surgeries, at least he has developed that habit of knowing how to handle the tissues with the instrument. So the robotic learning comes much faster if you have a laparoscopic background. Even the console surgeon who is sitting on the console, he would shorten his learning curve if he knows how to operate the laparoscopic instruments, because even robotic instruments are, at the end of the day, are laparoscopic instruments only. They are just easier to maneuver, but they are laparoscopic instruments. So the learning on the console is much faster if you know how to operate the laparoscopic instruments. The impact of the previous experiences, previous learning, if a person knows how to operate laparoscopy, can occur at three levels. The strategy making and communication with the team are new things which are specific to robotics, and they have to be learned specifically. So robotic learning also has a learning curve. But the sensory motor skills, the sensing cues for decision making, all these can be achieved much faster if you have prior laparoscopic knowledge and basic laparoscopic skills. So even console surgeons do benefit if they have laparoscopic knowledge. And I'm not saying this just to go on record, and there is proper literature available to that. There are multiple studies. This is one of those. This is another one. And there are several others. Not only that, there is a false sense of security because robotics makes it easier to maneuver these instruments. There is a false sense of security in the person who knows how to operate these robotic instruments. There is an overestimation of the over-surgical skill performance. You all might be knowing a recently hyped news of the patient Stephen Pettit dying because of the robotic surgeon. And otherwise, if he had not undergone that robotic surgery, he had a 99% chance of surviving the procedure, simply because the person didn't have a prior laparoscopic learning. He didn't know that the maneuvering of the robotic instrument would have led to the tensioning of the suture line, and therefore the patient died during the surgery itself. So he was removed from his job in England. And this is not one such incident. In USA, 144 deaths have been reported linked only to the technical glitches of the robot. Because of the machine itself, because the machine stopped functioning in between, the instrument broke, or it took a longer time just because of the repairing of the robotic instrument during the course of surgery, all that led to death. So the point is not that it cannot happen with the laparoscopic surgery. It can happen, but if the person has a prior laparoscopic experience, he can identify these mishaps before they turn into a whirlpool and the person drowns in that. Again, robotic needs laparoscopic to cover its back. On one side, if you are saying that a minimally invasive surgery is good for the patient, and on the other side, if your robot is not functioning, and you convert it into open surgery or render or de-anesthetize the patient for a second sitting, you are actually doing disservice to the patient. And your concept of the minimally invasive surgery itself stands on the shaky ground if conversion to the open surgery is not considered a disaster in this case. So the mandate is actually for the minimally invasive surgery, not robotic surgery per se. Do not convert any patient just because your robot is not functioning. Some legends might have developed the advanced laparoscopic skills, which includes Dr. Chaudhary also, but still their castle is standing on the foundation of their own basic domain knowledge of laparoscopy and laparoscopic skill of the team also. You know why CTVS, plastic surgery, etc. have not been yet been able to pick up robotics at the fast pace that the urology has picked up? The only reason being because they have no exposure of laparoscopy. Therefore, this again goes on to prove that laparoscopy is essential part of the robotics. So finally, I would say that all robotics in its current form is too dependent on laparoscopy and just can't do the last rites for laparoscopy as of now. On the contrary, you remove laparoscopy from robotics and it would vanish in thin air. So hyper-specialization in robotics serves no one. Console surgeon takes longer time to learn it. Assistant remains a shadow learner despite heightened laparoscopic requirements. And above all, the patient is left at the mercy of the machine. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rishi. Now, Dr. Gautam Chaudhary, who is the Associate Professor of Urology at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, Jodhpur. So he is going.
Good afternoon, seniors, colleagues, and dear friends. And thank you, Team Usicon Bhuvneshwar, for giving the opportunity to speak in front of audience and qualified urologist. And so, but before I start, I think, Doctor, I have to. I was seeing the presentation by Dr. DC, and probably he forget the topic. Topic is laparoscopic surgery skills required to be a good robotic surgeon? It's not as a whole surgery. Be it a whole surgery, then he presented nice, but because it is about the console surgeon and not for the whole as in a surgery and the including the assistant surgery and also. So he deviated from his topic. So from probably now there is no more debate. However, just I said it's regarding the console only, robotic surgeon, and he raised a query that what does mean by a good robotic surgeon? It means you acquire the proficiency, you master that everyone want to see you operating and you finish job in a right way where the robot have advantage. So, so he could not present in the topic, though he was beating the bush here and there. So this was the fight. He is from the Central Institute, big name, big fame, but hame bhi kamzor nahi samjhiyega, hum present karte hain. So before I come to the literature support and all, just introducing, both are the minimal invasive way. For the patients, of course, it's the keyhole surgery. We are removing the, or we are operating in the minimal invasive way. But for the surgeon, it's totally different. In a one patient, surgeon is standing near the patient and is struggling here and then, cameraman fighting with the cameraman. Whereas in the robotic surgery, you are comfortably sitting on chair. And so these, for the surgeon's perspective, both are different. And in the laparoscopic surgery, of course, the outcome very much, very much depends on the skills of the surgeon who is operating on the patient, especially suturing and operating in the difficult areas. Whereas in the robotic surgery, I feel that it's after a few cases, after the orientation and understanding of the robotic surgery, it's very easy to deliver a good surgery. So basics, learning is an essential part of the skill acquisition and of the surgical apprenticeship. For the successful performance of any task, a person needs to have both theory knowledge, which we keep on reading and acquire the knowledge before you enter into the surgical training. We all have the surgical theory knowledge, and how to do it, technical knowledge, which is practice-based learning, which starts from the observation to working on the simulator, some dry lab, wet lab, then easy cases, and then proficiency. So both novice and the experienced surgeons require supervision and mentoring during the initial phase of any surgical skill acquisition, and the robotic surgery, of course, is not the exception. So I'm giving the tabulated form of the both surgery, how they are different. So there is no need of acquiring the laparoscopic skill before moving to the robotic surgery. So if we start from the hand-eye coordination, so in the early part of our laparoscopy training, we have the poor hand-eye coordination. And with time, of course, this improve, but this is not required for the robotic surgery. So why to be in the, learn the laparoscopic skill to be a good robotic surgeon? Instrument movements in the, like this hand-eye coordination, they are counterintuitive, and straight, rigid instrument where the limited mobility in the tip of, at the tip of the instrument, they they are barrier to deliver a good dissection and some working in the difficult area. Whereas this is not true for the robotic surgery. Here the seamless instrument movements, and you can very well do perform a good surgery from the very first case. Ergonomics, as we all know, very poor in the laparoscopy, whereas better in the robotic. I would not say it's very, very comfortable, but of course they are better. And the vision, in the, if you talk about the laparoscopy surgery, it's a 2D and very much dependent on the assistant. While doing operating in the pelvic, where the surgeon stand, cameraman stand, it's, if it is lasting for more than two and a half hours, then it's a fatigue, it creates very fatigue. Whereas in the robotic surgery, 3D autofocus, so why to learn this, how to be dependent on assistant and how to work with a 2D vision when you have very good vision in the robotic surgery? So no need to learn the skill of the working in a 2D vision. So depth of the perception, constant oversetting in the initial part of the laparoscopy, of course, which improve with the time, but still sometimes it can miss the target, which is not with the robotic surgery. So again, there is no comparison. Bimanual dexterity, we all know when we start the laparoscopy, first of all, in initial cases, we use the one hand, dominating hand. Then, of course, with the time, we try to, and most of, we use both hands, but still it's difficult to suture with the non-dominant hand. This is not true with the robotic surgery. So again, why to learn this much of the suturing and the bimanual dexterity of the laparoscopy when I can very well use this in from the very first case in the robotic? Efficiency, of course, it's a very confident and efficient and safe conduct in the robotic surgery, which is not true for the laparoscopy surgery. And force sensitivity and the tissue injury in the laparoscopy, we all know this is not possible to handle the mucosa, very important area with the instrument, because of the limitations of the laparoscopy. Whereas this is not required in the robotic surgery. Few of expert, we might see that they even do not touch the mucosa, just part of the area, especially ureter, pyloplasty, they can very catch this and without damaging the tissue. So why to learn all these when I can do this with the very first case? And this is the laparoscopic surgeon. They have to learn where to put so that they can suture easily, they can work in the difficult access. Whereas once you put the port in the line, if you're talking the latest system, XI system, put the linears, okay, and put your assistant port. The whole job is of, as Dr. Isi said, it's on the assistant surgeon. Main console surgeon need not to do much. So why I should must know all these things to be in a good expert console robotic surgeon? Again, this picture showing the laparoscopic surgeon have to learn many, many things like carpenter or jeweler. For the producing a good job or good surgery, they have to see which angle he must work, where he should stay, where should be the camera, where should be the this display, and on which what instrument, and where will be the assistant, where will the sister, and all these. And well, it is very contrary to the robotic surgery, where you are just playing like video game, it's virtual, you are just seeing the screen very well in 3D vision. So why to learn all these if I am not, these are not helping me in performing the robotic surgery at sitting in the at the console? So let me see in some literature. It's written in, by the Williams E. Kelly. The most critical value of the robotic technology lies in the enabling the capabilities, allowing the surgeon to perform the complex tasks that would access their ability and traditional laparoscopic instrument. Cardiac surgeon, but Dr. Rishi said that in our institution, their surgeon, they did not pick the surgery, but in contrary, the coronary, the robotic was first started by the CTVS surgeon, and they could very well do the job with the robotic, and they were not laparoscopic surgeon. And same true for us and the gynecologist, where the laparoscopic radical prostate was not done very frequently. Nowadays, mostly it is being done with the robotic. And truly, if we all have robotic surgery, if the cost is constant, then we all will love to work with the robot, not with the laparoscopy, because laparoscopy is totally different from the robotic surgery. So Roni Abaza, he wrote, and in this paper, he was saying that why the laparoscopy picked so slow and late, because of the skill acquirement was the difficult, we all know, whereas in the robotic acquired fast and everyone is doing robotics. If you talk about me, I was not very much a laparoscopic surgeon, but robotic, after installation, we are doing regularly robotic surgery. But as Dr. Rishi already have said, where the role of the laparoscopic training in the robotic surgery, but because this debate is not pertaining to this, but however, at 4 point, while placing the, where the laparoscopic skill to the assistant is required, but not for the consult surgeon. One is the, if we found some adhesion and difficulty in placing the port, then the, of course the laparoscopic skills are required. Another situation in the anastomotic limitation might be better handled laparoscopically. Anatomical limitations better handled with laparoscopically in preparing some robotic procedures like kidney transplant or partial nephrectomy, pyeloplasty, or sometimes, of course, mechanical failure, then we must have backup with the laparoscopy, but nothing to do with a good robotic surgeon. It's not pertaining to that. And again, one paper by the Thomas E. Hellring, successful transfer of the open surgical skills to the laparoscopic environment using a robotic interface. So here they conclude that laparoscopically naive, yet experienced open surgeons successfully transferred open surgical skills to the laparoscopic environment in 8 to 10 cases using a robotic interface. This outcome is comparable to the reported experience of skilled laparoscopic surgeon after more than 100 laparoscopic radical prostatectomy. And by the Kowalski KF, they compared the 37 medical student and 25 surgeons and concluded that robotic assisted surgery required skill distinct from the conventional laparoscopy or open surgery. Basic robotic surgery skill training prior to the patient consent should be required. That we all know in initial part. So do laparoscopy skill transfer to the robotic surgery? In conclusion, for the simple task, participant with the pre-existing skills perform worse than the robot. However, with the increasing task difficulty, robotic performance is equal or better than the laparoscopy. So if we hear from the legends.
And was lap an advantage during transition to robotics? I would say that there was nothing in common except telling that both of them were minimally invasive surgery. So they are absolutely different. You have to actually unlearn so many laparoscopic skills when you start doing robotics.
So now I think it's clear that when you have Tesla car, then why I must know everything about the traditional old car, how to start manually, how what to work if the engine fails, in which gear I should work and all these, in which direction reverse is working, all these. So they are not comparable. The same thought is I feel. And hope I could make my presentation that traveling in aeroplane and traveling in train are different, so why I must should have all experience of the train journey when I am traveling in by air. Thank you.
Thank you. Rishi, you have 2 minutes for rebuttal.
My slide, please. Dr. Chaudhary has gone at length
comparing laparoscopy with the robotics, citing the benefits of robotics over laparoscopy, but that is not the point. The point is, can robotics really do without laparoscopy? The clear answer is no, it cannot, because it is actually a form of laparoscopy only. And it is not a new form of surgery, it is a form of laparoscopy only. And point you raised that one can directly move from open surgery and there is an easier transition to robotics, well, yes, everybody agrees on that point. Maneuvering the laparoscopic instruments is much easier with the robotics by your side. But again, just at the cost of repetition, unless you know laparoscopy at its basic level, you just cannot perform robotics. And if you add to it the necessity of the heightened laparoscopic skill of the assistant standing by the patient's side, then the clear answer is that you know much more laparoscopic know-how to proceed with robotics. Any robotic surgery needs a much more laparoscopy than a standard pure laparoscopy. So why this question even? Whenever you say that it makes the job easier for the surgeon, direct transition can happen from robotics to open surgery, all this is only for the console surgeon, not robotic surgery per se. If you have a tunnel vision of being only a robotic surgeon, then well, yes, you can transit from open surgery to robotic surgery much easier with a false sense of grandeur that you are a skilled robotic surgeon. But the fact remains that it is only the robotic team which is required for any robotic surgery. And the assistant would require the finest of lap skills, looking towards the patient's head and then operating towards the patient pelvis. And we have ourselves highlighted these heightened laparoscopic skills needed by the assistants in our own paper in the IGU. So when you consider all this, lap skills are definitely required for learning robotics. So the crux from the literature, there are so many papers to quote from which I didn't go through, but the fact is even the console surgeon would have a much shorter learning curve on the robotics if he has a prior laparoscopic experience. You said that it is just like operating a video game. Well, yes, there is another paper to counter that. Even the expert video gamers are not any better than the person who has a prior laparoscopic experience. Prior laparoscopic experience performs much better than an expert video gamer or a medical student or even a lay person. So if you have laparoscopic experience, you gain much more from robotics. And tools don't define a surgeon's skill. If you just know how to operate the laparoscopic instruments robotically, it will not make you a good surgeon. You have to develop the know-how of how to maneuver the tissues when you are inside. So if you decide to be a king without a kingdom, knowing only the robotics without the basis of laparoscopy, that's for you to decide. I rest my case. Thank you.
Thank you, Rishi. Gautam, you have another 2 minutes.
So I didn't prepare the rebuttal. So those who play video game, they will not be doctor. So there is no comparison because any that to be urologist. So, but it's like video game. Like they are different. I mean to say it's different. And again, in the rebuttal also, you have presented that it's a robotic surgery. So I feel there is no. To me, it's not even a debate. Because it's about the good robotic surgeon. So robotic surgeon who is sitting on the console is totally different from the laparoscopic skills and laparoscopic surgeon. So to me, it's not comparable. And in your first presentation, you told that the one death because of the robotic, it's not because of the robotic. It's a complication of any surgery. It's not because of the machine. If you don't know how to handle. So you must have orientation of the any new technology. It doesn't mean that if you learn the laparoscopy and then you move to the robotic, then the chances of error will be less. No, if you compare, then the chances of error and complications are less with the robotic than the laparoscopy. And death might be some with some other reason or some machine malfunction, but it's nothing to do with the console surgeon or the good robotic surgeon. And if you, as far as my knowledge, Dr. Mani Menon did not have laparoscopy skills, and he is one of the father of the robotic surgery. If I'm wrong, please, sorry. So thank you. That's it from my side.
Gautam, I have two things to tell. See, both examples exist. What you said, Dr. Mani Menon tried laparoscopic surgery and he was quite frustrated and he picked up the robot, and now his photo is there in the Smithsonian Museum for his contribution in robotic surgery. Dr. Inderbir Gill, who was excellent laparoscopic surgeon, and he was initially hesitant to start the robotic surgery, but once he started, it picked up so fast, and again he started doing all robotic surgery. In 2010, I went to Strasbourg for the 2 days training in robotic surgery. And in the lab, when I was doing the initial dissection, the guy who was the trainer, he came to me. "I think you do a lot of laparoscopic surgery." I said, "Yes." "Oh, come on, you have to change your movements. Some of the movements are counterproductive. If you keep doing that, then there'll be problem." So there are some changes, but I feel if you have some basic knowledge of anything, and if you have a basic knowledge of open surgery and laparoscopic surgery, you will pick up very fast. But since robot is a very good tool and it helps in gaining fast, so with limited experience, you can become a good robotic surgeon faster than a good laparoscopic surgeon. So with that, both have put their viewpoints, and I think it was a very good debate, and we will close here. And
thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Anand Kumar, and thank you, Dr. Rishi Nayar and Gautam Chaudhary. Well, now we come to the end of this the conference, and that's the end of the session. That's a valedictory function. Well, traditionally, the valedictory function is to express the gratitude and express the opinion about the whole conference, which has been organized by the organizing committee. And as you know, that these 3.5 days, the conference actually amounts to 3.5 days. But to make this 3.5 days successful, there's a huge amount of preparation which is required. The preparation not only lasts for 1 year, but actually now it goes before, it starts before that. And there are two aspects of making this conference successful. One is the scientific aspect, one is the organizational aspect. And if you have to express my opinion before I request our president, sir, to opine, that the organizing team under the leadership of Dr. Sahu and Dr. Datteshwar Hota has done remarkably well. We all met in Jaipur. We all saw Jaipur conference, which was extremely well managed, extremely high level conference. Everything was flawless. And that time itself, people started suspecting and people started opining that whether Bhubaneswar will match or not. But I'm here as a secretary from the Urological Society of India. I'm giving a very, very clear opinion that the organizing team of Bhubaneswar not only has come at par with Jaipur, but they have gone beyond the level which was set by the Jaipur conference. So I feel it's more than 100 marks to the organizing team. Now, before I throw upon the audience to express their opinion, may I request Dr. Ajit Vaze to say a few words and to give his opinion about the organizing of this conference, and then we'll keep the opinions from the audience. Dr. Vaze, please.
Dr. Sabnis, my colleagues, this is one of the many visits in Bhubaneswar as a president. And every time when I came here, I knew a different style and different aspect of Datteshwar Hota. It is said that a cat has 9 lives. But I'm very sure Datteshwar is an exception. Where is Datteshwar, by the way? You call him. 1 minute. We started with something as a very unpleasant problems. which we do not want to deal with any aspect, or I do not want to even talk about it. And thereafter, it was a smooth sailing all over the world. There were a lot of people who really helped here, right from organization level, how it has to be conceptualized, what are the various strategies to be done, what were the deficit in both Jaipur as well as in Mumbai, because they were the something known as a landmark problems which we had. And we had to go above these problems without disturbing them, gently, very softly. At the same time, the importance of scientific session was very, very correctly and beautifully done by Ravindra Sabnis. A true kudos to him. But right from 21st, when I came here in the evening, the welcoming response, the accommodation, the council meeting arrangements, the plenary hall, that is Hall A, Hall B, C, E, D, F, every single toilet which were cleaned, a signage, the distance which is traveled from point A to Hall B and thereafter several parts, the ease of all the people to go up and down, and at every given stage, both tea and coffee kiosks were round the clock available. There were more than 400 people, I was told, that were involved in this Safai mission, and you can see that every single moment, it was spotlessly clean, and I'm sure Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Amit Bhai is probably watching Hota very closely, who is this man who is trying to take away Swachh Bharat mission. An ever-smiling face, even at the point where he was quite visibly disturbed yesterday because the AGM lasted for 4.5 hours. But there was no speck or signs of uncomfortableness in Dr. Hota's face. I'm sure behind this kind of sacrifice for last 8 to 9 months of Hota, Mrs. Hota has really suffered dramatically. And please, Datteshwar, is your wife there, please? Is your wife there? Madhu, please come. Dr. Sahu, please come. Please come, Madhu. Please come, Dr. Hota. Please come, Dr. So it's my great pleasure in thanking Hota and Mrs. Hota and the team under able guidance of Dr. Sahu to make this a truly memorable conference. And I would like to thank him from bottom of my heart and Professor Sahu so that this kind of conferences should be repeated in future. I would like to invite people, especially the senior cadre and even the middle order and junior level, to express their views of how they felt a Bhubaneswar conference was like. Dr. Professor Ajay Kumar, please start from him. Yeah.
This mic. Now it's working, sir.
Well, I'm
Dusra mic dena.
From East Zone, and I think that, at the moment, Professor Rautre was also the president, but he was from the military quota when he was there. So I think from East Zone, I'm the only live president. I said he was from the military quota. Let me specify things. I'm a scientist. I do not talk this way or that way. I talk straight. So let me finish. What I found in this conference is, because East Zone has always been, people have been very skeptical in coming to East Zone for the conference for years together. And that is a fact. But I remember Patna conference when we had, Professor Vimalendu Mukherjee came to me on the before the valedictory function. He just patted on my back and he said, Ajay, I have a complaint. I said, my God, what has happened? Complaint is that I have nothing to complain. I think the same thing is being repeated year after year. Last time Senapati had the conference, hosted the conference, it went very well. This time, in spite of all the odds, I'm not going into the details because I was also part of solving the problem. There were a lot of problems faced by the organizing team led by Professor L.K. Sahu and by Dr. Hota. And the headquarters, let me tell you, headquarters was all the time trembling. Aray, kya ho jayega? Kya ho jayega? यार हो जाएगा घबराना नहीं है सब हो जाएगा इस जोन में ही चलता है ऐसे ही होगा एंड वी हैड फुल कॉन्फिडेंस इन द ऑर्गेनाइजिंग टीम अंडर द लीडरशिप ऑफ प्रोफेसर साहू एंड ये आई सेड नो वी विल दे विल डू इट एंड दे हैव डन इट एंड आई एम टेलिंग यू अगेन आई हैव गॉट अ कंप्लेन दैट आई हैव नथिंग टू कंप्लेन इन भुवनेश्वर इंक्लूडिंग यू आर एब्सोल्युटली राइट I went to toilet few times. Few toilets I have used because Gupta ji, my friend, always tells Dr. Professor N.P. Gupta, the sort of parameter of judging any house he goes to is the toilet of the house. That we have been talking. So the one of the parameters was the toilets and they were absolutely, I would not take much time only say big thank you to Professor Sahu and Professor Hota. Against all the odds, you have done it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Anybody else you want to say anything? Dr. N.P. Gupta.
On behalf of all the past presidents of the Urology Society of India, I like to express our sincere thanks to Dr. Sahu, Dr. Hota and their team. And as Ajay mentioned, against all the odds and the difficult situation of Bhubaneswar, because we know Bhubaneswar of 1999, when we had the previous conference and this conference, it's a sea change. And we like to congratulate you for all the hard work which you have done to make this Congress a great success. I have attended at least 35 USI meetings. And if you want me to grade, I will say 9 out of 10. Thank you.
Dr. Anand Kumar.
Yeah, I must say that organizing committee, Dr. Sahu and Dr. Hota did a very good job. And I must say Dr. Hota was there everywhere smiling and trying to help the people. Even though when I was asking for the stall, I know he did not have a stall, but he never said he will not give. But he tried his best and gave something. So and all the time, even standing in the sun and helping and asking everybody, with a smiling face, that was a great quality. And you give personal touch to all the delegates and you did a tremendous job and all the halls were very closely located. People did not have any problem. Even food, there was enough space for everybody and there was no queue for there. So everybody has enjoyed exhibition. Everything was very good and thank you very much for doing such a good job in Bhubaneswar.
Thank you.
This is Dr. Tapan Kumar Mandal from the. This is
Sir.
Dr. Tapan Kumar Mandal, senior from Eastern Zone. This is a conference of my zone. Therefore, I may be considered a little biased. But the job done by Dr. Sahu and Dr. Sarota is superb. I don't think it can be excelled anymore. The discussion about the bathroom, the toilet facility is excellent. probably it is a definition of excellence. And the food, it is of the highest caliber, sufficient food, no shortage, all items from, as he said in Bengali, Hira to Jira, that means from diamond to Jira, everything was okay. All item, all food items, both times of the day, it was superb. And in Calcutta, if you find, there are two of the Orissa people, they excel. One is the plumber. Out of 100 plumbers, the 95 plumbers are Orissa. They are the best. And about the food, about the 100 food shops, the Telebhaja, you know, this fried the bhujias, the out of 100 shops, 95 are owned by the Oriya people, and they run the kitchen so well. So I am this I have got no praise left for all the departments, and Dr. Sahu and Dr. Hota were, and all his team were all the time so smiling. They never lost their patience. And up to yesterday, last night, up to Shan's conference, I found Dr. Hota so cool, so patient, and his behavior, his restraint, his patience cooled everybody, calmed everybody.
Thank you.
Kudos to all of the organizing committee of Bhubaneswar.
Dr. Dogra, please.
Well, Dr. Sahu, Dr. Hota and their team, they really done a very commendable job. It's, I think, very noteworthy and very obvious. He has personally given attention to very small, small thing. Even right from the time you were received at the airport, you get a call from him and he knows that you have come. It's not only me, for everyone. And then give me personal attention at each and everything. He, wherever you go, you'll find him. Whether you go to the exhibition area, he'll be there. If you come to hall, he'll be there. If you go to the reception area, he'll be there. In the food court, he's there. So I don't know really that he was all the time so mobile, and everywhere he was present himself physically. And the arrangement was really superb. As I asked him, that he said that I have not sub-delegated anything to anyone. I am personally supervising. I think hats off to him. Only very few of us can do such things. It's not possible otherwise.
Right.
Regarding the scientific program, of course, the secretary is responsible for making it. But the delivery part has to be through the organizing committee. It was a audiovisual, and the other logistics support was really wonderful. The other thing, like you are in the social evenings, and the food quality was really very good. I think the food which being served in this conference, I have heard even Shin Gova from Japan. He told me that I have taken food in outside in a five-star restaurant, but I find the quality of food here we served is much better than that. I think that is a compliment. And you have done an excellent job. All the best, and thank you very much for giving all this.
Thank you. Thank you. Dr. Batyal.
Well, I am representing the North Zone, and I would just say two words. Logistics, hospitality, 10 out of 10. Academics, 10 out of 10. Both the organizing team here, Dr. Sahu and Dr. Hota, and the academic team, I would say the organizer, I mean the big bosses, Ajit Vajay and Sabnis, a fantastic job done, 10 out of 10. No words to express. Excellent.
Thank you. Thank you. Dr. Sanjay Kulkarni.
Yeah, I'm representing the West Zone. Dr. Ajit was a very close friend of mine, the president. He told me that he came here many times before the conference to check the arrangements. He came here 8 or 9 times. Dr. Ravindra Sabnis has done a fantastic job of so many new things being introduced in USI. Dr. Sahu and Dr. Hota, fantastic conference, one of the best I have attended. Thank you.
Dr. Ratkal.
Yeah. So I being the president of Association of Southern Urologists, I bring greetings from the Southern Urology, and I have no words to describe how Hota's involvement was there in the conference, including Dr. Sahu. Sir, even small details were taken care, the way he received at airport.
Correct. Correct.
And one most important thing I'll tell, I had brought my 5 nurses for this nursing course.
Right, right.
I had not booked hotel. I had not even done the registration for them. They landed and then they called me. Yeah, we are in the railway station. Hota was there. I approached him. Within 1 hour, their accommodation. His workforce is so good, it is commendable. And his personal involvement, really, I was very, very happy. See, such small details also somebody takes care. Being an organized secretary, he was standing all the time in that CRPF ground and sending us by cars, calling everybody. And that was really commendable, sir. What's up? Because I attended 99 conference also, and this has made the world of changes because of you, sir. You have made the change in Bhubaneswar.
Thank you. Dr. S.P. Yadav, please.
I'm from the North zone. Congratulations to the president, secretary, organizing team. I think they get 10 out of 10. And to the president for yesterday's GBM, everybody expected a lot of problems and went very well. Honestly, scientific program, more than 10 number out of 10. Sir, 3 cheers to you all.
Thank you, sir. Yes.
So, Dr. Vasudevan from Kerala. So for me, the conference started when I registered with the smiling face of Hota sir at Jaipur. And it has been a combination of several good things. Excellent weather, nice venue, excellent hospitality, nice program, especially all congratulations to Sevenis for the innovative sessions. Something which we all wanted to hear for a long time, which should be part of our curriculum. And of course, excellent debates all along, nice participation, especially as Sabni said, from the middle age group of our thing. So excellent, all in all, excellent conference, 10 out of 10. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Myself, Sudeep Chakraborty, I'm at present the president of Bengal Urology Society. I don't know how to express my feelings, and thanks to Dr. Professor Hota and Professor Shahu and all the team here who have worked so hard. Everybody was appreciating the food, the hospitality, and all these things. There's nothing, no wonder. Orissa is known for this. I remember long time back in Konarak, at least more than 20 years back, one Brahmin, he was just offering us food in Konarak temple area. The way this man, he was very rigid and looking like an Aryan, and absolutely spotlessly clean in a very small place. I will never forget the quality of food, hygiene, and the way he distributed with so much of affection and love. And that's the beauty of Eastern India, that's the beauty of Orissa. And Dr. Hota, as everybody has told, always smiling, fantastic patience, and against all odds, he has absolutely successfully taken the entire responsibility in organizing such an excellent USI meeting. At first I was hesitant to come. It was Dr. Hota who helped me last moment, and for some personal reason, I thought it was not possible for. But in fact, I attempted, and the first day we had to go back from Bhubaneswar because of fog and all these things. I went back to Calcutta, and again because of him, I could not resist myself to come back again in one day after. And now I know if I wouldn't have come, what I would have missed. So, congratulations. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you.
My salute to Mrs. Hota.
Thank you. I would just like to tell the last, but not the least, that when the organizing team was working so efficiently and so flawlessly, the USI office was also set here. And for last 3.5 days, or actually more than that, the USI office team also was working flawlessly, and they did the job marvelously. I request Navneet Arora, Kiran Arora, Tony, Rahul to stand up. Let us give them a big round of applause. That they were behind the curtain, but unless and until they had done that job well, we would not have shown this sort of the effect what we have shown. So thank you very much, all of you. Well, I have a special request to accept this token of appreciation from the USI to the organizing team. Last, I will request Dr. Hota, Dr. Sahu to say a few words, and then Dr. Hota to say a few words, and then still I have a last duty to perform, which I will do as a secretary.
Friends, 3 days back, that is on 23rd of January, during the inaugural session, as the chairman of the organizing committee, I had the opportunity to welcome you all to this conference. And I assured you, as the chairman of the organizing committee, to look after all your comforts, to make this conference a memorable one. Today, at the valedictory session, I am speaking to you from the same dais to convey you my sense of gratitude to each one of you who have come from different places, from different parts of the country and from abroad to make this conference a very successful and a memorable one. I will take only 1 minute, and I want to express my gratitude on my own behalf and on behalf of the organizing committee to senior stalwarts of Urological Society of India, Brigadier Raut Rai and Professor S. N. Panda, who have been with us from the very beginning, guiding us, and during the stormy weather, they were providing us the moral support to go ahead to make this conference a success. I really want to convey my gratitude to both of them. I want to speak on this occasion. Mr. Manoj Naik is present here. He's the chairman of the SOA. He has extended unconditional support for the success of the conference. We had several rounds of meeting with Mr. Naik in his office, and he entrusted two of his main hands, Jyoti Babu, he's sitting over here by his side, and Dr. Lenka, to look after everything during the conference. And that's why you find, you will not find even a single piece of paper lying here and there, immediately being removed by, under their supervision. Dr. Hota and his team have been sending their sweat during the last 1 year, struggling hard to make this conference a very successful one. And at the end, I thank the lady behind the success, Sujata, Mrs. Hota, who have been, from the very beginning, she is a silent worker by nature. I know her for last more than 2 decades, and she looks after everything, keeping herself away from the real scene. And the success of the conference goes more to Mrs. Hota than Dr. Hota.
as I have been judging from the very beginning of the conference. With these words, I convey my gratitude to the East Zone, Harpreet, Dr. Paul, our USI Secretary, Dr. Sabnis, and the President. They have been visiting and paying us all moral support to go ahead in spite of all odds. I thank everybody, and at the end, I want to say from the very core of my heart, well, in such a big event, some problem might have occurred here and there, which have been brought to our notice also, and I give all credit to Dr. Hota and his team for the success. I take the blame for anything happening little otherwise here and there against our wishes. Thank you very much.
Mr. President, sir, Honorary Secretary, President-elect, my chairman, Professor Sahu, Mrs. Hota, I should address also. Well, as I stand here, I would express only one thing. Life is a learning every day. I learn every day, every hour, every moment. Well, before I further proceed on what I have to say, we have to honor a few people who are really the backbone of the conferences. You are all aware that from this year, it is not organizing committee, local organizing committee, it is joint USI and the local organizing committee. This time, it is USI and UFO, Urological Academic Forum of Odisha, it is jointly hosted. Dr. Waje, Dr. Sabnis, Dr. Agrawal, Professor P.N. Dogra, Dr. Rajiv T.P., all have been part of the organization. They are not out of. And I'm fortunate that Dr. T.P., also Rajiv T.P., is also part of the local as well as central organizing committee. We had a very tough time. We could overcome the tough time with the help of God and my friends and well-wisher. We had so many occasions, we thought that possibly we will not be able to hold the way the delegates expects or to do. But at the end of it, if you remember from the beginning, we have been given communication that we will try to do and extend a hospitality in a traditional Odia way. I hope we have been able to come to that extent. Now, I would request our president. You know, there are lot many force behind the success of any conference of this magnitude. And I would request to give a token of appreciation. And I start with our very revered, very respectful Mr. Manoj Ranjan Naik to kindly come on dais. Please come to the dais. And we have got a very small token of appreciation for you, sir.
Bouquet first.
President, USI will honor. We have with us Dr. Madhusudan Agarwal. In a short while from now, he's going to take over as president. That's most possibly the last agenda of the day. He has been all along a guiding force. We have talked at late hours in the night, or you can say early hour in the morning also. He has been a big guiding force all along. We'd like to request our president to honor him also. Can I call upon our beloved Professor P.N. Dogra to come and give us the opportunity to honor you, sir? Professor P.N. Dogra. Can I request our esteemed president to honor also Dr. Sabnis, our legendary honorary secretary? We'll do it again, sir, in the valedictory because you are here. Yes, you have to be, sir. Come. There has been a lot of groups, individuals have supported in the success of this event. We cannot acknowledge and appreciate the role of the MCI, the event management team. I would like to request Mrs. Shweta Sharma to come on dais and accept a bouquet from us. MCI has done a tremendous job for the whole 1 year. Dr. Shweta representing Mukul, representing Udit, they have done a wonderful job. Wonderful job. Bouquet. Bouquet, please. No, bouquet. It is only a token of appreciation from our side. I can remember all the organizing committee members. Our chairman has been very understanding. He has stood all the time behind us, has given the guidance from the top. I cannot but express my deepest gratitude that he has been a guiding force, not now, since I was a student. He was my teacher also. And I believe that in future also he will keep us guiding. Now, my students all over sitting over there, please stand up. For last so many days, you know, they have been staying here. They have been provided accommodation. They are doing it from day and night. They have been struggling. They have been working. I wake them up very early in the morning. I say whether things are in order or not, I get a feedback. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. Please sit down. At the end of it, before I conclude, I hope the support of USI staff already acknowledged by our president and secretary, honorary secretary, Mr. Navneet, Tony, Kiran Madam, and all others who have been supporting. They have come 5 days prior to the conference and giving us the guidance. Thanks a lot, Navneet and his team. I believe at the end of it, any conference is not successful without expressing the deepest regard to the chairman of the reception committee. Professor S.N. Panda, who is again a teacher of mine, he has always been very categorically guiding us about all the decorum and decency of a conference, the protocol. And he has always come forward in all difficult time. We are very grateful, sir, Professor S.N. Panda, sir. All the members, they have supported me very well. Why I stand here today with happiness? My happiness is because you are all going back happy. And that is the only thing I pray to God. Let nobody go unhappy. Thank you all.
Well, before we close down, it is my last duty as a secretary to announce the prizes which we have conducted, the competitions, and this which we conducted in this USICON. The CKP Menon Best Paper Award goes to Dr. Rahul Jena. Chandigarh Best Video, first prize Rakesh Sharma, second prize Kishore T.A. Vijayawada Poster, first prize goes to Dr. Pankaj Joshi. Second prize to Tillu Niraja. S.S. Bapat, first prize goes to Ashish Patil. And Brish Kishore Patna, prize goes to Dr. Ashwin Navankar. So congratulations to the winners. Now may I request Dr. Vazey.
Friends, I will start something from Sound of Music, an epic song. There was a very beautiful song. It says, somewhere in my life, I must have done something good. I do not know whether I deserved this post or not. But I put my heart and soul, tried my level best to give USI everything. As a duty of president, I tried to maintain a camaraderie all throughout, probably AGM. Excellent atmosphere all throughout from last January to this. Avoid obvious fights or troubles, and promote excellence and make a very good academic background, and thanks to my right-hand man, Ravindra Sabnis. We both, along with now my president, within 5 minutes, Madhu Agarwal, will try to make India as a center stage. In fact, we will be forming a consortium of 8 to 9 nations which will hover around India as a substation, so that once we sing everything in unison, even the Western world will take a deep note of ours. We tried to do a lot of good things. We brought a good amount of people from Western world, the best of the best in each subspecialty, and obviously all of you have seen for last 3.5 days, the clinical excellence which has been beautifully demonstrated. I had my failures too. I sincerely wished that I could amalgamate SIU and USI. And in spite of the fact that there was a huge amount of resistance from few sectors and few quarters all over India, I did try till the last. Unfortunately, we couldn't do it. It doesn't matter. So I will end up by thanking you, everybody, and also Viva, because I have given her a rough time for 2.5 to 3 years, and probably will continue for 1 year more. I will end up my presidential speech by giving a small song. Muskurane ki wajah tum ho, gungunane ki wajah tum ho, jiya jaye na jaye na jaye na ore piya re, ore lamhe tu kahi mat ja, ho sake to umr bhar tham ja, jiya jaye na jaye na jaye na ore piya re. So I end my presidentship by garlanding my honor to a better and a deserving person, Madhu Agarwal.
Dr. Wazir sir, all my friends in the council, the executive, my seniors, my teachers, my friends in USI. Dr. Wazir, you've been like an elder brother to me, and you will continue to remain so. You've been a guide, and I'll always cherish the affection that I have had from you and all other members in the executive and the council until now in this last 1 year and for the times to come. I'm thankful to the Urological Society of India, every one of my seniors, teachers, and members for this affection shown to me, for this honor that has been given to me. I only hope that I stand true to this honor that I have received, and I prove to be what I start with. So let us look forward to a good year, and we'll try to look up to, stand up to your expectations. We've been blessed with a great new council, and we are looking forward to a great another year's meeting. We had a fabulous meeting in Bhubaneswar. Dr. Hota has done a wonderful job, and all the whole team Bhubaneswar has really made us proud, and we are looking forward to the next year with even greater expectations, because I believe that every meeting has to be better than the last one. So I thank again USI, Team Bhubaneswar, and I welcome you all to year 2019 and 20 and to USICON 2020 Kochi next year. Thank you so much.
question 19 before?
Thank you very much. Thanks, everyone. The lunch is now served, but I'll request all the members of the council, the outgoing members as well as the incoming members, to please stay for a very short post-council meeting, which we'll have just now, and we'll then join the lunch.